here at the college, and I have the great privilege of leading these fine musicians here tonight, all of them that you're going to see before you, and in what we hope is a very enjoyable, patriotic program for you that we've prepared for you.
I wonder which one is it.
For our first piece this evening, our first six pieces are going to be just the concert band playing, playing works for winds and percussion. And so the first piece this evening that you're going to hear is we will share the music of Pulitzer Prize-winning composer Morton Gould. This piece was originally written for orchestras, you know, our friends that saw away on the strings, but has become a concert band favorite over the years. And it incorporates the very famous Civil War era tune "When Johnny Comes Marching Home," and as the melody. And what Gould does here so masterfully is he sort of develops this theme and he weaves together this kind of brilliant little fantasy on just that one tune. So trust me, when we're done playing this piece, you're gonna know that tune very well if you don't already know it. I'm telling you. So please enjoy Morton Gould's American Salute.
Thank you.
thank you all so much. For our next number this evening, this is sort of a sing-along, perhaps a whistle-along if you can, sort of a march, military march. And it was written in 1923 for the dedication of the Nuremberg band shell in New York City's Central Park. And Mr. Goldman composed On the Mall to credit a local philanthropist named Elkin Nuremberg, who backed the band shell's construction at that time in 1923. And the title comes from the park's large mall where the bandstand is placed, and where, you know, New Yorkers would gather and enjoy listening to concerts. When his band performed On the Mall, Goldman would invite the audience to whistle the little memorable tune that you're going to hear in the middle section of the march, known as the trio. And this invitation for folks to participate that way still happens today. It's sort of expected, if you will. So we're all expecting you to whistle and sing on the little syllable we say la la. So get ready to do that. And what I'll do is I'll simply turn around and invite you to join us. So you'll get to hear the melody. So we'll give you one time through to hear it, and then just one time. And then you can whistle and sing along with us, and we'll have a big party. It's a great time. Please enjoy Mr. Edwin Franco Goldman's On the Mall.
Jim Fabricio.
Thank you.
in our program is Make Our Garden Grow from the musical Candide. And Candide was Leonard Bernstein's third Broadway musical after On the Town. And the musical is a take on the French writer Voltaire's sort of 18th century satire on what has been called blind optimism. At the core of the story is the philosophy that all is for the best in the best of all possible worlds. So for the operetta's protagonists, we have Candide and Cunegonde, and they make their way through a number of life scenarios that sort of rob them of their idealism, to ultimately seeing the closing number, Make Our Garden Grow, near the end of the work, which is the song basically of hopefulness, as they realize that the only purpose of living is to cultivate the earth and create a garden. And perhaps this is somewhat of a metaphor for the navigation of life and the human condition in any age, I think is a message we can take from it. And so please enjoy, to slow the pace down a little bit, Leonard Bernstein's Make Our Garden Grow from Candide. Senior BA music major here at Young Harris College on the trumpet, so we appreciate Rex's playing. Yes. For our next piece,
how could we leave out the great John Philip Sousa? This march by Sousa was composed in 1893 and within a year was sold in versions for piano, band, orchestra, various string instruments, mandolin, everything. The title comes from a few things. The influence of a painting of the Liberty Bell in Philadelphia that Sousa saw actually in Chicago. Sousa's own son marching in a parade in Philadelphia that honored the Liberty Bell. And then lastly, Sousa's own unabashed patriotism. And see if you can hear Sousa's recreation of sort of the cracked Liberty Bell sound, if you will. Hint, hint, listen back in the back of the group for the percussion. So, my favorite section. I'm just kidding. Harmless words. I play drums. Okay, so listen for that bell. It's great fun. So please enjoy John Philip Sousa, the Liberty Bell March.
Thank you.
Michael Krause, music major on the chimes back there.
Yeah.
Adores him. Yes, sir. Thank you again for your service. The Magnificent Seven was released in 1960 as an American Western setting of a 1954 Japanese film, Seven Samurai, and with a cast including the stars like Yul Brynner and Charles Bronson. And as our good friends over here that I was talking to a second ago, they said, you can't forget Steve McQueen. And of course, I can't forget Steve McQueen in that film as well. And it's come to be known as one of the classics of that variety of our genre of film. The film's composer, music score composer, Elmer Bernstein, not to be confused with Leonard, who you heard earlier, received its only Academy Award nomination, unbelievably, for musical score. And that musical score, I'm dating myself as I did in front of the students the other day, has been used across the past several decades in a number of television ads, commercials, TV sitcoms, so on and so forth, and just immersed into American popular culture that way. And so we hope you really enjoy. The film's great. Please enjoy. You'll know the tune. You'll know it. Please enjoy Elmer Bernstein's The Magnificent Seven.
Thank you.
the winds and percussion alone, the concert band, Washington Grays, is perhaps Claudio S. Groffola's best known of the works that he penned between 1838 and 1870. It remains pretty much a staple in the military band repertoire, and Washington Grays was written sometime prior to 1852 for the 8th Regiment New York National Guard. And the 8th New York Regiment was founded on May 1st of 1784 by Captain Jacob Seabury as a company of militia artillery in New York City. And the group actually marched in George Washington's inaugural parade on April 30th, 1789. And with that came the name Washington Grays. So we ask that you join us in our final number with just the band before the choir comes up. And please enjoy Claudio S. Groffola's Washington Grays.
Thank you.
Numbers of the evening, and the first of which is My Country, 'Tis of Thee. The melodic source of this tune is a little obscure, but it's thought to have come from Europe. And the national anthem of the United Kingdom, God Save the Queen, shares the same melody, I think you'll recognize. With text written by Samuel Francis Smith, My Country, 'Tis of Thee was first performed on July 4th, 1831, at an Independence Day celebration in Boston. And the piece was published and sold later as simply America. Dan Forrest's setting that you're going to hear this evening combines the forces of the concert band and the soprano alto tenor bass choir and utilizes a variety of different musical colors and textures. And so we hope you enjoy, now that we have the full forces of all the ensembles here, Dan Forrest is setting My Country, 'Tis of Thee.
Thank you.
band's musical, Miss Liberty, is where our next number comes from. And it was inspired by a book of the same title written by Robert E. Sherwood. The musical story is a fictional narrative on the creation of the Statue of Liberty. And the finale of the musical is called Give Me Your Tired, Your Poor. And the title stems from the text of Emma Lazarus' poem, The New Colossus, which is found inside the lower level of the Statue of Liberty. The text is set brilliantly to song by Mr. Berlin, and the poem reads as follows. Not like the brazen giant of Greek fame, with conquering limbs astride from land to land, here at our sea-washed sunset gate shall stand a mighty woman with a torch, whose flame is the imprisoned lightning, and her name, Mother of Exiles. From her beacon hand glows worldwide welcome, her mild eyes command the air-bridged harbor that twin cities frame. Keep, ancient lands, your storied pomp, cries she with silent lips. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. This setting by Roy Ringwald is often programmed for patriotic events such as this, and we hope you enjoy Irving Berlin's Give Me Your Tired, Your Poor. fire pit going out here. Okay. Our closing number of the evening. God Bless America was penned by Irving Berlin in 1939 at a time when a world war loomed. And its hopefulness made it a hit rather quickly in 1940. And Berlin stated, "It's not a patriotic song, but an expression of gratitude for what this country has done for its citizens and what home really means." Berlin's tune has had a great impact on the country since then, and as some Americans might say, it's officially, God Bless America is, maybe unofficially, the national anthem of the United States. We close this evening's performance with this tune, and perhaps Berlin's most famous one. We thank you all so much for coming out and spending your evening with us and joining us here in the sharing of great music, we hope, and what a splendid event this has been for all of us, students, faculty, the entire university. We're so glad that you're here, the entire college, and we hope to see you at more Division of Fine Arts events in the very near future, and out in on campus, and of course out in the community as well. And so please enjoy our last number of the evening, Irving Berlin's God Bless America. Thank you all so much. Trip home, and we hope to see you again in the near future, very soon. Thank you. Thank you.